Cabinet. Are there any apologies for absence? We are all present. Any declarations of interest? The minutes of the last Cabinet meeting on pages 4 to 10. Or I believe they're a correct record. Agreed. Any matters arising?
Thank you. Appraisal for the future delivery of waste and recycling services under Resolve B. I'd just like to understand the progress and outcome of current discussions on that.
Thank you, Chair. We're still working on this. We're waiting for the market to stabilise and for Gola to commission its new supply chain. Meanwhile, the Council is continuing to benefit from the new cap rate until June of 2016, and we envisage that the current talks will finish by September, which then will be, I'm happy to forward on the outcome of those reports.
Great.
For options, appraisal of the future delivery of work services is currently undertaken by Keir Harlow. Point B, Cabinet will receive a third report in July 2015 to determine final option of the procurement strategy. Could we have sight of that report?
The report hasn't been finalised yet. There are some outstanding issues with the evidence base. It is planned to come to a special meeting of Cabinet probably in August.
Late August, early September.
But as soon as the report is available, absolutely we'll make sure you have a copy of that.
It's been four months since the last Cabinet meeting, obviously nothing's been going on. Look at item 150, communications from committees working groups, scrutiny committee. Resolution A was to produce a leaflet. I'm wondering if that's been produced yet, because it's been circulated.
In progress.
It's still in progress.
Currently, when it's been taken, a date round is now in post.
Sorry,
I'll take on time. It's been taken too long, sorry, to be looking at. It's been taken to the hate crime. It's been taken to the hate crime group to look at. So it has been gone through much with that.
And that's all done in 4 months.
Anything for that? Yes, sorry, to catch up where we are. So that's happened with the link that's gone forward. A data analyst is now in post, and it's starting to undertake the analysis of hate crime and investigate any trends. So that's going forward. We've involved Harlow Arts Trust to explore the possibility of an Anne Frank exhibition in the gallery. And there will be a joint meeting of scrutiny and youth council to discuss that. That's still to be arranged at the moment.
Okay, I'm not talking about a leaflet. I'm not talking about the Arts Trust or anything, but a leaflet. The initiative to develop greater understanding of hate crime in Harlow through the production of a leaflet that could be utilised in schools and public bodies in regular contact with members of the public is approved. So 4 months later, nothing's happened.
Right, okay, sorry, it has gone to the group and they're working on producing it to go to the school. It has gone to the group, the hate crime group, which deal with the leaflet.
Right. Thank you.
Any more matters arising?
It's item 154, was taking a confidential session at the Ramble's Covenant release. Again, it's one of these situations where delegated to delegated to Head of Place and Regional Enterprise to complete the negotiations. this is obviously this is quite a big issue, it's been running on for many years.
I can confirm progress has been made, but I can also confirm the negotiations are still going. But positively.
I won't hold my breath.
Oh, do. Not my nerves. I'll take it.
Thank you.
Right, where are we doing? Item 4. Yeah. So there are no written questions in the public, no written questions from councillors, and no petitions. So item 8 is forward plan on pages 11 and 25, which is for noting. Are there any questions or comments? Councillor Charles.
Thank you. First of all, can I thank the officers for providing me with a briefing on the asset management strategy and progress on that. I'm satisfied, happy, content with that. One of the other things that I'd like to thank the council for is the progress the officers have undertaken under Michael Pitt to look at updating members who raised the motion about access issues and customer services for people with disabilities. I also welcome the fact that councillors have been asked to complete a online survey, which I've done. I did 20 of them at work for my induction, so I've well versed with all these sorts of tests, and I think they're an important mechanism to make sure people understand quality matters, issues and ways of conducting yourself for people with disabilities. So I very much welcome that. I welcome the fact that actually it's mandatory for staff to fill in those sorts of things. Michael Pitt has been in consultation with Councillor Carter and I about these issues, and I'm very satisfied with the engagement that we're having with the council. So I welcome what they're doing to try and address the issues that all councils are responsible for in terms of the public sector and quality duty, that all of us in this chamber hold in high regard, because it is people with disabilities do need support and guidance in the council. So I welcome that. The only other matter I wanted to raise, it's been a regular feature of the forward work panel, I've raised it several times, is the local development strategy. We're very grateful just for an update on where we are with that. Again, it's unallocated. I recognise the issues that we have, not just in Harlow, but across Essex, in terms of the duty to cooperate, but still I would like an update. I want to know where this is going and when we will finally get a realistic timescale to present something to members.
So the current state is that the plan leading up to endowment and public in 2017 is still in place. That will include a consultation on the preferred options in 2016. There have been a number of ongoing conversations around duty to cooperate with neighbouring councils, principally with Epping Forest and East Harts, but including Broxbourne, Ruddlesford, several London boroughs, and Essex County Council. I think it's fair to say that a number of surrounding councils have some dispute on their particular object assessment housing need, particularly around the strategic housing market area assessment, or the SMART for short. While Harlow has accepted the view about the SMAR, the other districts and boroughs haven't. So I've expressed a strong desire that at some point we're going to have to draw a line under the duty to cooperate, recognising it's not a duty to agree, and push forward. So I've made it clear that I would certainly not want to see the plan date moving beyond the current plan date, which is 2017. I'll just note in passing that Epping have moved their date back to 2018. And if there is any way of accelerating that should be done. So the local housing plan panel is meeting shortly. The general vice president want to appoint the and chair of that committee. And I'll simply repeat that I express a strong desire that process is accelerated at all. Unfortunately, a lot of these issues, particularly around cooperate, are outside of Harlow Council's hands. But I do absolutely want to draw a line. We can't keep going round with this loop.
Great. Sure. I can't allow the forward plan to go forward without some reference to slight reaction, which I'm I know it wasn't on the March 4 plan because you're doing something with it and incorporating it in something else, but again, it's one of these issues we don't want to lose sight of.
I can assure you that we're not losing sight of it. As I said at the last time, there was a delay because actually what we want to do is bundle this up into a package that would be attractive to bring different types of housing for different parts of our community. But certainly it is one of my priorities over the next 12 months to try to resolve that and to work with partners to find a long-term solution. So yes, it will be coming on the forward plan.
Thank you.
So item 9, just a note, decision of the Portfolio for Housing at page 26, agenda, Councillor Carter.
The annual report's terms and leaseholders attached to the appendix A to the report is approved for publication. I'm still waiting for it to be published. It's not downstairs at reception. Copies weren't available on the terms forum last night, which was in a suitable form for it, and none of the terms I've spoken to have seen it either. So, is it going to be published, or are you providing more terms like that so they can see it online?
It's ready to publish. I thought it had been published. I've checked why it hasn't, but it would be published as soon as possible.
Where will it be published to?
Website, and we also send it to some people in the council, and we'll make it available as background paper and we'll send it to tenant representatives.
And copy available downstairs?
Yes.
Downstairs?
Yes.
It has actually been published on the website. I did manage to find it eventually, but not much further than that. But time is moving on. It's the report for 13-14, we're now to 14-15. A lot of time and effort went into producing it. There's an awful lot of good news into it, and I thought the Council of the Portfolio would be keen to push it out and promote it.
Item 11, the appointment of Cabinet overview, working with panels and partnership bodies at pages 29 to 30. Any comments or questions on that? No. For those recommendations of the appointments in that document are implemented. Right. So item 13, which is the year-end joint finance and performance report, it's on pages 35 to 75. Which is the Cabinet Overview Working Group Work Plan, at pages 31 onwards. Any comments or questions? So, in that case, we'll agree that that is the work plan for the 2015-16. Okay. Well, sorry, now item 13, the year end work plan and performance report. I want to do brief remarks before I open up for questions and comments. It's clear that Council have been under continuing pressures with reducing budgets, but I am quite pleased that there's been a steady improvement and good, strong financial management. And for that, my thanks go to the many officers involved, both in the day-to-day management of the Council, particularly with the financial management, an underspend of less than 1%, and 90% of the performance indicators are at or above their target levels. I'll address some of the specific performance indicators in a moment. But just on the financial bit, there remains significant risk to the council's finances. Clearly, we don't know what the outcome of the spending review in November is going to be. The sort of more lurid headlines are not encouraging in terms of local government not being one of the ring-fenced areas for public spending. And clearly, there is some significant risk of that. That the already challenging savings that have to be made in the identified in the midterm financial strategy will get worse. Clearly, we'll have to await the outcome of that. You'll see in the report that the reserves have been increased from their recommended minimum level of £2.5 million to about 3.7, and that's partly to reflect that uncertainty around long-term financial planning. In terms of the performance indicators, on page 47, there have been significant improvements. Obviously, things like abandoned call rates in Condahalla have been raised at Cabinet in the past. That is now at a reasonable level. I'm not saying that we take our eye off that particular ball, but I continue to monitor the abandoned call rates on a weekly basis, and they're around the sort of 3%, which is a significant improvement over where they were 12 to 18 months ago. However, clearly one of the issues identified in the performance management report is around the time to respond to complaints within Contact Harlow. As part of that, we're about to start a fundamental review of the whole customer contact strategy, which will cover a broad area, including things like how we encourage people to use alternative methods of contacting the council, sort of channel shift in the technical jargon, but also how we can provide information so that people don't need to contact the council. But that's an area of we'll be contacting in some depth. I will leave it there for the moment, but clearly I'm sure there will be questions about it.
Thank you. Another issue arising, you probably imagine. Just to start off with a technical issue, hopefully page 51 can be put correctly in the minutes so that all the numbers actually align. The way the numbers and the words read doesn't make a great deal of sense, but I persevere.
So it's just on that particular one. Apparently it's a feature of the modeling of converting the document into PDF, so I'm acutely aware that some of the columns
excellent. We've got page 61, BB203, people sleeping rough, on page 62. The way forward that there is the reference to St Mungo's sort of trust that they've been appointed to look after South East Essex. They've been in place for almost about a year, probably a year in September. So I'm wondering, probably not tonight, whether you can quantify the support provided by St Mungo's as to how many homeless preventions they provided and people they've housed. Bearing in mind that this is the way forward that you're looking to actually improve that performance indicator. I can actually tell you now that they haven't done anything in the last nine months. And if you're looking, probably be careful what I say, but if you're looking to do some mangoes as a way forward, I think we're going to be disappointed. The main reason, the report does provide a breakdown as to why people are sleeping rough, but the big issue in the last 12 months is the number of East Europeans who are not no longer eligible for benefits. Actually won't go home, and they seem quite content to sleep well. So what can we actually do about it? By the way, on page 70, which is quite a bit
Just on the sort of homelessness statistics, I'm acutely aware that it's something that
we as a council on all sides and tenants involved and everybody who has a stake in the council needs to keep their eye on and make sure that we're doing everything we can, and also working with external organisations as well to make sure that we have as much of an effective response to this issue as possible, particularly keeping an eye on the different changes to benefit rules and all the rest of it that's going to take place. And so I'd like to take this opportunity to thank those that are involved in the town in homelessness provision, because I think it's very important.
Thank you. Moving on to page 70 on carryovers, I assume you've all read pages 70 and 71. If you have, I'll be intrigued to how you've achieved it. There's a lot of detail in the very small print. If I can refer specifically to election expenses, $15,000 to cover the possibility of a by-election. There's a couple of others I'll be referring to. This is to cover the cost of a by-election occurring in 2015-16. So it's not a carryover of unspent commitment, it's a by-election from one budget to another in a different year. There are a couple of items for legal services, $11,000 and $5,000. These also are not carryovers, they are provisions that do not relate to activities in 2014-15. Staff development of $17,000, that's also not a carryover. It's unspent in 1 year on spending the activity required for something different this year. These appear to be ways of achieving budget cuts in 15-16 by carrying forward unspent in the previous year. And I'm wondering what the accountants view that as a carryover. Just one other issue on carryovers, there's also a fair number of items on the ingresso system. This has been dragging on for a number of years, and I just wonder when the upgrade will actually be complete before we actually then start adding the add-ons that we need to put on there. But I'm concerned that there are some items being marked as carryovers where in fact they're not. And those with slightly longer memories will recall a previous Labour leader of this council who would not allow carryovers. It was budgeted in that year, you either spent it
Professional, I leave it in the hands of the professional accountants, Chair, rather than Councillor Carter. And I trust, in terms of Simon Freeman's staff, to actually be able to actually properly account for these figures. Thank you.
It's a question.
Page 60, the performance indicator in terms of customer complaints responded to within the target time. What would be really helpful for councillors is a breakdown of the top 10 complaints that people are raising. I understand that housing has produced a similar list of some of the complaints that come through, but I think for members it would be handy to see where the key pressure points are, what the complaints are, and it would help guide particularly the scrutiny committee,
who've
been looking at this area.
Yeah, happy to produce that and get that side of my head around, get that to
any other questions, comments?
Can I just make a brief comment just to bring the sciences to people's attention? On page 58, Keir Harlow JV Cole Performance, it does state that Keir Harlow met 81% of its 59 monthly targets. The 81% should read 94. That needs to be amended, Chair.
Thank you. Right. So with that amendment, recommendation 8D on page...
Of course, we welcome particularly the targets being achieved in terms of waste. This is something that the Conservative administration brought in and that was bitterly opposed by Labour, and I take great pleasure in bringing that every time because actually the council is performing incredibly well in in comparison with other local authorities, and it was always very disappointing when Labour refused to back what is an excellent scheme and the office's hard work to actually achieve that. What is unacceptable is the way that we deal with complaints. Now, yes, for three quarters we were hitting the target, but now we're missing the target again. Again and again, we're told that year on year there is an increase in complaints to this council. Well, that should be a red flag to anyone. Now, I recognise that the leader of this council says that every week he gets a report in terms of the complaints that are coming in. That said, there are serious issues here. We do need to know and understand what are the key areas of complaint that residents are bringing up, and I appreciate the fact that the deputy leader will produce that information. But as an opposition administration, I think it's important that we get to the bottom of this. Scrutiny is looking at this matter and has brought in the manager for Contact Harlow and has discussed this matter with him. But I think that it's an area that needs constant observation and scrutiny because we're just not dealing with the issues. Whether there's a capacity issue that needs to be looked at in the next budget, that has to be looked at. And I welcome the leader's comments on those sorts of issues and dealing with the capacity problems. One thing I would say is that there have been teething problems, reporting issues in terms of complaints. I think we've all had that. But what I do welcome is the hard work of Lisa in the office, who I find has been very helpful to me in dealing with some of the councillor inquiries that I get an awful lot in Harlow, and she deals with them as best she can. But there's clearly capacity issues there because of the amount of complaints that we're now getting from residents about the services the council provides.
Actually, what you just said, that clearly it's something we need to take very seriously. It is being looked at, as I say, by scrutiny and an independent organisation looking at the whole customer engagement and strategy. The new councillor response mechanism has a relatively recently been introduced. I think that there are teething problems in that, but if that's your order, she's happy to look at those as well. I can assure you that I'm taking it seriously. We'll get the data in terms of the breakdown of the complaint types. One of the specific issues, again, a bit of a technical jargon around plainly a demand management, i.e., why do things go wrong in the first place that we need people to complain? So looking at the whole process, not just where it hits the council when things have gone wrong. These are absolutely things that I'm particularly keen on looking at, and I've expressed that view very strongly in terms of council.
Yeah, on the same point, and I understand the issues that Council Charles has raised, but I think it's also relevant to recognise that since April, the council have been working with care on this subject, and since April, there's actually been a reduction of by a third, in the amount of complaints that Harlow Council has complained. So, in a short time, complaints have actually gone down a third in that time.
Just a side issue, I have specifically asked for a breakdown of the types, but the specific numbers of complaints, there's a little bit of confusion around the graphs in terms of the period you're talking about, whether they've gone up or down. Actually, in the overall trend, going back from 2013 is down. The change in the last year is, from a graphical representation, is marginal, actually. But I am getting the detailed analysis of the actual numbers. So I'm just reiterating that we're not taking this seriously. Any further comments? Right, in that case, the recommendations on page 35, 18, are we agreed? So, item 14, the Housing Review account outcome report on pages 73 to 85.
Thank you, Chair. Can I please move the recommendations A to D on page 73? This report, a very important report about where we are with the housing revenue account. As members and colleagues and members of the public, tenants will remember, back in 2011 there was cross-party support for self-financing, which is very important in terms of allowing councils to make their own decisions about the housing need within their particular area, charging their own rents and all the rest of it. We've been very successful in developing a decent homes programme, which thankfully we met this year in March. We're also now looking at a modern homes programme, and we've had to, under the sub-financing programme, build a 30-year business plan where we set short, medium and long-term objectives. And so far, for the last 3 years, the first 3 years of the business plan, we've been able to meet those objectives. I'm concerned with recent announcements from our Chancellor about the future of self-financing in terms of local councils being dictated to about the levels of rents they set and other matters with regards to housing. And this will have a big impact on the future of social housing within local councils. And I would just like to make that point, I think it's very important. Self-financing had cross-party support. That seems to have been taken away recently. And I think it's just very important that we recognise the importance of local councillors, local tenants, local people making decisions over their own housing matters.
Yes, Chair, if I could carry on with that. This council was saddled with over £200 million worth of debt with the promise that it would actually have control over its housing policies. These have actually just been ripped up by George Osborne. And it really is getting quite alarming in terms of being able to actually plan for decent homes, to carry on our building programme with any kind of certainty. And we wait, obviously, the autumn statement, and presumably will be even more gloom and doom. But we cannot actually start to house people in the public sector. We're getting ripped off with housing benefits by private landlords. £30 billion now goes into housing benefit. Instead of actually building and creating housing, we're going down very much the wrong avenue, and this government seems to not be willing to actually listen to these kinds of requests.
Councillor Carter. Before we go through the questions.
I'm a member of the Cabinet, and I was seconding this particular item, thank you.
Recommendation B is to make a working balance of 10.87 million against a target of 2.6 million. So I'm just wondering what you're planning on doing with that £8 million. It's quite a lot of rent, it's about a fifth of the annual rent roll. And therefore, was it necessary to have £500,000 of vacancy savings when there was that much cash in the
HRA? Yeah, if I could, Chair. Yeah, the relationship between the housing revenue account and the housing capital programme needs to be carefully managed. And we have to make sure our reserve balance, particularly what we call the MRR, and the revenue contribution to capital, is at a sufficient level, not just to support having revenue account, the housing capital programme. And you see sometimes large fluctuations in that as we are supporting the capital programme. So we're happy with the rigour and the outturn as it is.
So basically it's just a sort of cash flow issue at the moment, isn't it, the amount of spending. Okay. In the absence of the Housing Finance Panel over the last 4 months, why did this report not come to the Housing Standards Board last week for review by the tenants and leaseholders as it normally does?
The reason for that, I'm not sure it was ready to come, and we want to make sure that all the figures are in place for that to happen, and we try to do that as well we can, as best we can, and I see that going forward for that happening through the new arrangements that I'm having to recommend to go forward.
Coincide with Cabinet, so then you're forced to go to Cabinet to go to HSB first. But, okay, moving on to some comments rather than questions on page 82. Appendix A. So, again, again, it's a small bit. About a third of the way down, there's increased rental income of £107,000. The faster turnaround of void properties down to around 0.5%, where the norm is around 1%. Again, had this come to one of the panels, this would have been picked up and congratulations passed to the various strands of housing and care in achieving such an excellent result. That's the kind of thing that happens with the panels. Also, on that page, page 84, the provision for bad and doubtful debt has been reduced from a original budget of 360,000 down to an actual 152,000, which so it's been halved during the year, and also halved what the actual outcome was the year before, which again suggests some excellent work by the housing rent teams and workfare support teams, and perhaps the portfolio would enjoy me passing our congratulations to them on their hard work.
Yes, certainly.
Any more comments? So the recommendations on page 73. I thought you were done by now. I'm going to be thinking about the year. I'm a little bit sort of relaxed about this. I assume you're going to address your comments during the debate. We'll carry on.
I know the comments from the proposer and seconder about the announcements in the emergency budget with the reduction of 1% in the rents for both local authorities and for social housing. Clearly, it's going to have an impact on the 30-year business plan, and I assume papers will be going in due course as to what the impact will be. But also some comments about the control of rents, as if that was something shocking and new. I think that the CLG has been controlling rents for about the last 15 years with rent conversions, and also with the assumption going forward for the 30-year business plan. Landlords also have to be cognizant of what the housing benefit levels are as well, when actually considering what rent levels to set. So there's nothing sort of particularly new or shocking about that. It's interesting that Gaz and Dab has picked up on the 30 billion for the housing benefit, which equates to, it equals the same amount which is being spent on working tax credit and child tax credit introduced by that wonderful Chancellor Gordon Brown.
Future social housing. When I first came onto the council and somebody said take an interest in one area and just focus on that, and I ended up going on to housing committees and all the rest of it. And I'm more worried now than I have been, because when I first became a councillor back in 2010, self-financing was on the table, and the logic is there. The logic is to have local councils and local people having say over their own particular housing issues. This recent announcement is going the other way, it's going backwards. It's going against the grain of what George Osborne is doing in other ways, which is to talk about devolution and all the rest of it. This is centralising housing services and all the rest of it, and I'm worried about that. A lot of the unknowns, for example, on how do we know about people's earnings who are social tenants, because, of course, one of the announcements was about people earning over a certain amount having to be charged market rents. And my concern would be about the details of that. How are we going to know what people are earning? And of course, people who are earning, for example, £28,000, £29,000 a year, they have a chance for a promotion, are they going to go for a promotion if it means that they're going to have to pay a different rent? So I've got concerns about that. It seems anti-aspirational. I've also got concerns about how we find out about people's earnings. And people's earnings, of course, change over time. And I've always maintained the principle of council housing as a secure tenancy, something that people choose, as opposed to buying a house. Not everybody wants to buy their house. And so I've got very deep concerns about the future of council housing and social housing in this country. And I've said all along that it's not just being the Conservatives who failed with social housing. My own particular party, when they were in power, they also failed in terms of stepping up to the mark, if you like. And I hoped that after the 2015 general election, someone from somewhere would take on the mantle, but sadly that doesn't seem to be happening.
Any further contributions? So, recommendations A to D on page 73. Are we agreed?
Any agrees?
Move on to item 15, the capital programme action report on pages 86 to 95.
Chair, I'm happy to move recommendations A to D on page 86.
Seconded.
Any questions?
Recommendation 4 about the outdoor gym in Town Park. I noticed the council has been tweeting furiously this week to actually promote it, following my example last week. I'm just wondering what we're actually doing about sort of promoting it and telling people where it actually is, because it is in quite a remote location and you need a map to find it.
Attempted to use it myself, but I'm not quite sure how the machines work. But at the end of the day, there are people queuing up to actually use the machines.
Chair.
Sorry.
Also, as somebody who walks around there every day, I think it is quite well used, bearing in mind its novelty, as it were.
Every time I say it, must be more used as well. I think he was advertised actually in the Harlow Times, because on social media traffic and what have you, both on Facebook and Twitter. I think lack of use is not an issue currently.
With respect, yes, there are people who use the town bar regularly who will see it. I'm not quite sure where Council Downs is going about talking about machines, but if you've not been in the town bar, I'm not sure how to describe how to get to it. Anyway, I'll talk to you later.
Alongside the car park.
Moving on. If there are no further contributions, so the recommendations on page 86, A to D, are we agreed?
Agreed.
So item 16, the housing property development board business cases, pages 96 to 98.
Yeah. Chair, I'm happy to move the recommendation on page 96.
And happy to second the recommendation, Chair.
Any questions, comments? So the recommendation on page 96, are we agreed?
Right.
Item 17, starting on page 99.
Chair, I'm happy to recommend A to C on page 99. This is an independent report that was commissioned at the 3-year point into our tenant and leaseholder engagement. We're having a 3-year review. I think it's only prudent and right that you have a review on an ongoing basis of how you do things in the council. Firstly, I'd like to mention the positives in terms of the commitment that is contained in the report from tenant and leaseholder volunteers, and I know that they spend countless hours of their own time to get involved and to assist and to challenge and to try and improve council housing in the town. And of course, all of us around this table are very passionate about making sure that the 9,000 or so households out there get the best service from the council as possible. The report actually mentions how the current structure works in terms of linking to the cabinet system with the Housing Standards Board and then panels within that. However, it does identify that there are too many panels currently in existence that often duplicate roles and responsibilities and often meet too frequently and have too few involved tenants and leaseholders. It also does recognise how there has been an adversarial relationship between councillors, tenants and officers, and it does suggest that the current system structure is no longer working effectively. So there are some proposals that it's recommending, and the first one is to reduce the number of panels, and I think it's really important that we emphasise that we need to have officers who are on the front line working as efficiently as possible, and so reducing the number of panels and making sure that the tenants get specific support in terms of the accountability of the council is very important. Also, this new structure meets the Homes and Community Agency standards. Co-regulation has two strands which it meets. One of them is to do with customer service, and one of them is to do with the economics of running a housing service. I'm very conscious as portfolio holder for housing that I have a duty of care to the people within the organisation, as well as to the 9,000 tenants in the town. And because of particular issues that have taken place in terms of behaviours that have been demonstrated, the report recommends that in the short term, officers are going to be chairing the panels for the initial stage until we have some firm terms of reference that would be created. So it recommends as well that we have a more effective and robust performance management system, and we increase staff capacity to deal with these issues, but most importantly establishing those clear terms of reference, and finally suggesting that there's a wider community approach as well that the council can look at. I understand from last week's Housing Standards Board that not all the current tenant representatives support these recommendations, but as I said, this is still within the realms of the Home and Community Agency's co-regulation system. This still has tenant and leaseholders at the heart of the service. It still is going to be making sure that the council is challenged and that the council has an effective process of making sure that people are involved within their housing service. And within the actual report, there are many suggestions of how we can improve, and certainly I'd like the council to work with tenants and leaseholders over the next few months to look at some of the areas that we can improve. So under Appendix 4 in the report from the independent report, there's many different aspects, for example, involving young people. And of course, we now are in a position where people don't necessarily want to come to meetings, and we can have a look at other approaches in terms of getting customers and tenants and leaseholders involved. So, Chair, I'd like to recommend the recommendations A to C on page 99.
Seconded, Chair.
Any questions?
Right. Thank you. turning to the recommendations in paragraph 17 of the agenda paper, there's a distinct lack of deadlines to any of this. It refers to a short-term realignment. When does that start and when does that finish? How quickly and how soon will the new panel meet? Then for paragraph 2 of paragraph 17, we also have another short term in reference to chairing the panel's biopsies. Is that the same short term as the other short term? And how is that going to work? I'm just wondering when the Housing Standards Board is due to meet again. The agenda paper last week said the 1st of September, but there are no HSB meetings in the council diary. I'm just wondering why that was.
There will be a Housing Standards Board meeting in September. In terms of going forward, the panels will be working with current tenant and leasehold representatives to establish the panels as soon as possible. And at the Housing Standards Board last week, we mentioned that we'll give the first stage of these proposals a six-month time frame. And it is my ambition that we have the chairs of these panels being tenants and leaseholders again once the terms of reference are clear and everybody understands them.
Thank you.
Members of the board, if the usual members are the chairs of the panels, can't really have officers attending the Housing Standards Board as chairs. So how's that going to work for the first 6 months?
We'll work through that, Councillor Carter. I think we want to work with current chairs of panels and to make sure that there's a joint approach to going forward at Housing Standards Board, to make sure that we address the work plans that are going forward and the issues arising. And we'll work out those details as we meet with the panels in August.
Also, I assume that the panel meetings are going to be open meetings. We're talking about to review community engagement. It's just that it's interesting that the leasehold panel is shown to be an open meeting, but the environment panel, which for one's on side was actually created out of the housing panels, is shown as a closed meeting. I just want to clarify that they will be open and they will be accessible to all.
Yes, indeed. And on the note of the environment panel, discussions have been held about the future of where that lies within the organisation, within the council, because, of course, the environment panel is often attended by non-council tenants as well. So in terms of the wider community engagement, how will we address that particular issue?
Deep politicised the panels by removing councillors. When I asked for evidence this last week, answers came there none. The author of the report, who was actually at the Housing Standards Board, could not recall specific examples of where there had been political debate or comment on where they're going on in the meetings. And this is quite important because obviously it's one of the key changes being proposed. So, how do we know it was actually councillors making political comments and not the representatives? At the report review meeting with the representatives a couple of weeks ago, none of them could recall any politicisation. So where is the evidence to prevent councillors being members or attending, bearing in mind that we all have the right to attend all meetings?
Well, this is a conclusion from the report, and contained within the report, there are a number of comments from people involved who were interviewed, comments from tenants, comments from councillors, who do actually mention about the politicisation of some of the particular meetings. Now, the practice across most councils is that panels are there for the tenants. Panels are there for tenants to get involved in their housing service, and then issues can be then pushed up through the accountability streams, through the Housing Standards Board, into the Cabinet, and so on. And there has been, if you read the report here, there are a number of sections where there are comments that have been made by, and it's not just councillors, by councillors, tenants and officers who are talking about the politicisation of the panels. And I think that's really important to note, that as portfolio holder for housing, my responsibility is to the 9,000 households out there. And I think that's really important. And so the panels have to be tenant orientated.
I've read the report quite thoroughly. There is a lot of repetition of a number of comments, but I, even in there, I can't find any specific examples of where it occurs or who was actually speaking. Paragraph 18, as you've already mentioned, refers to wider community engagement, but it's very vague as to how that engagement can actually take place and what it actually means. You know, where are or where is the community engagement going to be? You referred just now to Appendix 4 of the report about involving young people. As you can't become a tenant below the, well, except in extremely rare circumstances, can you become a tenant below the age of 18? I'm not quite sure where their involvement is going to be. That's not to say that they should be, you know, they can't come to meetings, but how they can actually be involved in the co-regulation and accountability aspects. And so, you know, and how far is this community engagement going to go? You know, does it actually mean that owner occupiers will be sitting on the tenant panels and voting on housing standards? So, you know, where are you going to draw the line?
On wider community engagement, I agree, I think it's very important we need to look at it, and therefore I'm proposing that scrutiny committee very early on have a look at the wider community engagement at the council, and so I'd like to propose that. But coming back to your points about the political nature of it, just a couple of quotes. Members of panels are often aligned to political parties, and this is demonstrated. I mean, that's in the report here. And these are some of the comments I've had from people actually. Meetings are becoming politically biased, passing notes in meetings, and I got told that was from a councillor to a tenant. Also, some of the behaviour that is there, but I think it's just really important that we do keep this as tenant orientated.
Passing notes. It's hardly a political activity. I'm not quite sure how subversive that's supposed to be. Ending on hopefully a positive, you did refer to some of the other recommendations in the independent report, such as publishing a menu of treatment options, and also identifying how technology can be better used to engage. There have been a number of attempts, I mean, for example, Keir Harlow, several years ago, introduced a repairs app, but unfortunately hasn't really taken off. The council did run a sounding board for a while, but that sort of thing will disappear without trace. And sadly, with the actual report itself, the author report did email, or invite email comments from various people. Sadly, nobody replied. So I think we've got some way to go.
Where's the tolling?
Chair, just to come back, certainly looking at technology is very important, and absolutely, how we can engage people in different ways. And it's very difficult to get tenants and leaseholders involved unless there's a particular issue with their particular property, but certainly I agree we're trying here to look at ways to improve it, and the kind of methods of communication and the new Facebook, Twitter or whatever it is, but looking at all the different angles that we can reach out to people so that they can have an impact on their housing service.
No more questions for the world. I really despair of this report. We need to have a triennial review. That was commissioned about last December time. The report was ready in March. Here we are 4 months later, and it appears to be rushed through. When I asked about deadlines, well, probably around 6 months, and then we might do a bit of something else. We've read this as to why councillors are being picked on for criticising meetings. That's not there. My own view is it's just a fig leaf to the administration's intention of doing away with tenant engagement. The report was produced in March, but I say only made 2 weeks ago. There is nothing in the report to suggest why relations between the representatives of the council have broken down in the first place. Now, if you're going to reform tenant engagement, you need to find out why the existing model has fallen down. And there's absolutely no reference to that, except one line, which says there is mistrust of the council amongst many involved customers. By customers, I assume you mean tenants and leaseholders. And the report tonight just shows how much contempt the administration holds tenants and leasehold representatives. Despite the recommendations of paragraphs 17 to 19, you have already agreed that the council will not attend the forum. It's not a decision for this agenda, I think. You already agreed. If you look at the very last line or very last paragraph on page 30 of tonight's agenda, points of health, etc., the very last sentence says housing standards will not have council representatives in 1516. So that's that then. That's already been decided. And if I refer you to the final sentence of the report before you tonight, paragraph 21, page 102. The Housing Standards Board considered the final amendment in speaking on the 14th of July, where it was noted that the tenant and leasehold representatives present did not support all the report's conclusions and recommendations. In fact, the only person at that meeting on last week to support the recommendations was the portfolio holder. There were two other councillors there, Bill and myself. We didn't agree with either. So what is the point of having a housing standards board if the portfolio holder is just going to ignore what everybody else says? Where is the co-regulation? Where is the participation? Where is the consultation? Is it any wonder that there is widespread mistrust of the council? They're just going to ride roughshod through the borders. They're just going to ride roughshod through the borders.
Clearly, I'm disappointed with Councillor Carter, but in all fairness, not surprised, because he's always had a negative attitude when it comes to independence and impartiality. At the end of the day, at the end of the day, this is an independent commissioned report. It was taken by independent people. It listened to people independently. It took views from people independently. And they have come up with independent recommendations. If this Tory group is now saying that they are disregarding the independency of this, then I think it's a sad indictment of your policies. Can I also say, I think it's actually a brave and positive step that we as councillors are accepting independent criticism about how we managed and how we possibly ran those services. And I think it's a mature council that is prepared to listen to an independent review, take note of that independent review, and make sure that we get it right for the rest of our community. So I would like to place on record my congratulations to the panel who made this, and I welcome the work that the portfolio holder is doing on this matter.
Yeah.
Chair.
This actually is important. It is important to have tenant and leaseholders involved. There is nothing in this structure that does not involve tenants and leaseholders in the service. There is nothing in this structure that doesn't ensure that they have an opportunity to challenge the housing service. This is a really important report in terms of making sure that meetings are not duplicated, that meetings are effective, and that people who are involved in tenant and leasehold engagement have an opportunity to move their housing service forward. So therefore, I would like to agree with Councillor Durkin. It was an independent report, and I would like to continue with my recommendation.
Down in leadership on tenants and leaseholder engagement. That's a fact. And the public's reaction today spells that out, and they welcome what Councillor Carpenter's done in his decades of service in this council. So frankly, Councillor Durkin, pay a bit more respect to Councillor Carter and his years of service for housing matters, okay? This isn't party political. This man works tirelessly by all councillors. And don't try and attack his record, Councillor Durkin, because he's an upstanding member, irrespective of politics. So don't you dare do that. On this report, let's be quite
clear.
On the report, Chair, as it says in the report, the tenants and leaseholders made it quite clear that they do not support the report's conclusions and recommendations. The reaction from the public here tonight spelled that out, and Councillor Carter was fair and right in what he said. So pay a little more respect to individual members. And Councillor Carter was fair and right in what he said. So pay a little more respect to individual members.
Chair, I'll just be very brief and support a lot of what both Councillor Durkin and Councillor Truan have said. And I think there's a very important paragraph here, which is, I believe, is on page 124. Which I think sums up my support for this. It is our view that the current structure of tenant and leasehold involvement is no longer effective or efficient for the council, its officers, and involved tenants and leaseholders. Tensions are evident between involved customers and officers. There are too few involved customers and only limited initiative engagement opportunities. What we've got here is an independent report that tries to address that kind of issue, that opens that kind of initiative up. I certainly welcome this report. We have to move forward with ideas and ways. Just to be sitting with your head in the sand is not an option. If there is an option of moving forward and to improve the way we engage with tenants and leaseholders, and I welcome the fact what Councillor Truan said about overall community engagement and taking that to a different committee to look at. I think that's a welcome opportunity. But what the administration have in front of us at the moment is an opportunity and some recommendations given by experts who are independent as a way forward. And I welcome this report, Chair.
Thank you, Chair. I welcome the report as well, because having been on the Housing Standards Board and a couple of the panels, it's imperative that we actually spread through the number of different tenant reps, youth council possibly, disability, ethnic minority, different types of tenants and leaseholders that we can put into this sort of panel is got to be healthy for any council. It's not something that we should shy away from, because the more of a group of people that we can get, the bigger they are, then we'll have a much more open and productive panel and thinking and way forward, and that takes the load off the amount of tenant leaseholders that we've got right now that are doing a lot of the panels themselves, because no one else is coming onto them. This is one way of committing ourselves to the 9,000 tenants and leaseholders that we've got in this town, and making sure that we have a vast majority of people from all different situations in the town that can get together and form these panels and make sure that the council is committed and productive in its resident community and resident forum structures, so that we go forward together with officers, with the councillors on the Housing Standard Board, scrutiny, etc. Because that's what we're in the name of, treating people in the town with respect, and councillors and the residents, etc. So I think this is an extremely useful way forward for an independent body that hasn't got any
system that they are going to sway one way or the other. They're totally independent.
Housing's not very much, and I will willingly admit that. But I have to say, the point of order for me is, and I don't know the ins and outs of this, is what has happened to elected members by the public of Harlow not being allowed to go to a meeting in this council?
Again, just to say that this is an independent report. It gives some suggestions of ways forward for tenant and leaseholder engagement. I just want to pick Councillor Carter up on one issue about where he mentions contempt for tenants. I'm actually proud to be portfolio holder for housing. I think it's a very important role, and I take the role very seriously. I grew up in a council house. I'm not able to access council housing, and I think it's very important that council housing is expanded. I know the value of council housing. So for me to have contempt for people who are residents in council housing, I think is not true. I agree with Councillor Holkin. I think the whole issue is trying to get more people involved, and it's to try and get as many, not just the same people, not just the same four or five people involved. We need to get as many people involved in their service as possible. And at the end of the day, what we're trying to do here as a council is to make it better for the people out there. And this report hopefully will try and extend tenant and leaseholder engagement, and therefore I recommend A to C.
Great.
Right. Item 18 on starting on page 158, rebuilding the Burnhill Lane public site.
Move that, Chair.
Seconded.
Oh, I think I'll take questions and then I'll maybe respond in comments afterwards.
Any questions?
Residents that live near the Burnhill area, i.e., Gibcroft, Sidney's Green, and Lodge Hall, have been consulted about this measure. In the 4 months or third of the year since the last Cabinet met, what other options have been looked at in terms of dealing with the capacity issues for travellers in the town pitch provision?
We've explored a number of options in looking at things like, such as transit sites and different things. We have tried to reach out with Essex to try and push to other authorities, because as we know, Harlow, we've got a pretty good reputation of upholding our responsibility, but unfortunately our neighbouring districts often don't, and we're trying to be pushed out to try and make sure that that happens further. But at the current point in time, we don't feel that it's appropriate when looking at a new transit site and whatnot, and maybe that's something that we'd look at in the plan, but we'd be keen for our neighbours to fill their things, and this is what we've
done. I'm concerned as to whether we're actually getting value for money for this contract. It's about £41,000 to rebuild a plot. The land is already there. The plots aren't terribly large. The services are already laid in. So where £41,000 goes, a bit of a loss to understand. And even just refurbishing well is £14,000, which I suspect is all just to relay. Some concrete and a road. Presumably this has been out for competitive tender, and presumably Essex County Council are quite happy with the figures as well.
We will feed that into them. It will be them and their responsibility within the tendering. This is what, between us and Essex, we believe will be the cost to put forward to get the grant. It has to be tendered for Essex if we're successful in the grant.
Just a couple of questions. I understand there are 21 plots in One, I understand these residents pay council tax on all bills. How many of the 21 sites are occupied? And what is the sort of turnover there?
Thank you. Sorry. It's currently full, and it has been quite a while. I don't believe there is a big turnover with that currently. It has been very static, that we will see some. I'll get the exact information to you, but I know currently the site is completely full.
Potentially, there are 24 plots at Fern Hill, and from the reports I read, there are two in good order, 10 need repairs, and 12 are derelict and need a lot of work. I understand also 30 families waiting for these. Why, after all these years, have we allowed these 12 to be derelict? Why haven't they been derelict? At the moment, also, how many of the potential 2,400 are occupied? Who do we have on our waiting list? Are these people known to us? Are they residents somewhere? Are they willing to move to these sites if we get them refurbished? And one of the other questions is that if they are willing to go to the site, will the existing tenants?
Both sites, but in particular Fernhill, is owned and managed by Essex County Council and has been for a number of years. It has been an issue that it's been derelict for so long. It shouldn't have been there for so long. And I think, obviously, the issue we had past 18 months with illegal encampments pushed our hand to feel we really needed to be in a place to push to make sure these weren't derelict anymore and that something was being done. I think we felt that we were pushed to do that. I'm not quite sure why it's been left so long. Essex don't seem to have a response so much on why it's been left so long. The waiting list is all with Essex, it's all done through Essex. There are obviously families that are interested in plots in this area. And that would be down to Essex, obviously, to go through. It was still the land and the plot will still be managed and still be the responsibility of Essex County Council. And it will be down to them to decide who is allocated. And with that, and obviously, work. But we're keen to work with Essex to try and make this a smooth transition.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Councillor Toll mentioned in her opening, unless I heard it wrong, you were actually considering going forward in the future a transit site. I hope you realise that, and I'm sure you do, so forgive me, this is not meant to be impertinent, that a transit site would be one transit site and it would be for all of Essex. So why would you consider it in Harlow?
It is something we're trying to push Essex. They say they've got no authorities to try and enforce it within the districts, which is where the problem lies about how do they enforce across districts that everyone pulls their way. And that we have a transit site in Essex, as you said, to try and alleviate some of the problems that us and
other places like Forest and South End have encountered
recently.
Any questions? Comments?
It's been an interesting week, particularly as Councillor Carter and I, when we first received the Cabinet reports, it was interesting that this report was buried at page 158 of a 202-page document. Interesting, may not wanted members to see what was in the detail, but we read every report. Equally, it was interesting the timing of the press release that was issued by Harlow Council. What was interesting that Harlow Star left at the bottom of that press release that the statement was supposed to be issued on today's date, but was rushed out all of a sudden. Maybe it was because there was a flurry of inquiries, not just from the Harlow Star, but from members, opposition members as well, and a number of questions that we have raised on this report. Ultimately, when you look at the report on page 158, there are serious questions that need to be answered. As we've just discovered, the council wants to spend £70,000 to match fund what Essex plans to do, but they haven't consulted the residents that live in the locality about their council taxpayers' money, that £70,000 that Harlow Council wants to use to refurbish these derelicts. Pitches. They haven't consulted residents that live in that locality. Now, social media has exploded about this issue, and Councillor Carter has fielded questions from residents, and so have I about this matter, and people are deeply alarmed that the council is rushing this through. We've also heard from Councillor Toll that they've looked at one single other option, a transit site. This is a wider discussion that Essex is having about dealing with gypsy and traveller provision, which is the right thing to do, to look at the provision across Essex. And when you look at the pitched provisions of all the smaller councils that combine the Essex County Council, Harlow sits in a very strong position, middle of the table almost, in terms of its pitched provision, in comparison to larger district borough councils that have a smaller pitched provision. So we're already punching above our weight. Equally, what I find alarming is that since the last Cabinet meeting, over 4 months ago, again a third of the year, the only two options that this council briefly looked at is to have kind of a discussion about transits, and then look at this option to bring 12 derelict pitches into line. Now, what I've discovered tonight, thanks to an email from officers, is that the council has already spent on dealing with illegal encampments in terms of the clear-up and the legal bill,
now 91,000. Add the 70,000 that they plan to spend, that comes to 161,000. Now that could afford a build to build a new council home, because the average cost of council new build is 134,000. So there's a question of priorities here, and housing is one of the biggest priorities. I think that members should have been given the opportunity in the length of time that we've had before the hearing on the full injunction that's going to be held in August. There should have been plenty of time, not just for the cabinet to rush through a paper, but for members to understand and debate this issue and come up with options themselves. Where is the democratic accountability? Where is the transparency? And where is the consultation with residents? There hasn't been. And we're just rushing this through before we come to the discussions, legal discussions on the full injunction. Now, if we take the discussion on the full injunction, I noticed in Councillor Tull's comments in the press that this would contribute to our legal attempts to get a full injunction. It isn't the silver bullet that actually is going to win us the case. We've already secured the interim injunction because we displayed the amount of pitch provision we already have in comparison with other local authorities. It's not the silver bullet. It's clearly not the silver bullet to solve this solution. Ultimately, this is a question of accountability and transparency. Residents have been given an opportunity to discuss this matter, and councillors have just been fired Russia over, and the cabinet's just making this decision. I'm deeply alarmed. This isn't a priority for residents. Our priority, yes, of course, is to support the campaign for a full injunction, but this isn't the solution.
There's clearly a misunderstanding about a number of issues about planning law to start with. So the first thing to say is that, and this is why study was done, to provide a number for the objectively assessed need for travel provision across Essex. We referred to the local plan and the timetable for that earlier on in this meeting. Recently, Malvern's local plan was thrown out for the inspection in public on the sole basis of not making travel provisions against their objectively assessed need. So it is absolutely vital, if we are going to get a local plan supporting aspirations for growth in this town, that we meet objectively assessed need. Now, what that says in the case of Harlow is that we need 9 more pitches up to 2018. It has long been said, it hasn't been rushed through. I personally have mentioned this on a number of occasions, going back over a year, about the way we're going to meet, and at a public meeting, which I'm not sure whether Councillor Charles was about, but certainly the leader of your group was, about meeting that permanent pitch travel provision. And the view would be that of the two sites that are owned and managed by Essex County Council, have planning permission for travel provision, that a key option was bringing the derelict sites back into use and improving the existing sites that in theory are in use but are in a bad state of repair. So it's absolutely about meeting our planning obligations. And a demonstration of Malvern's plan, and I specifically raised this with the appropriate government minister in a meeting I had with our local MP a week or so ago. So we absolutely need to do this. Secondly, in terms of the injunction, nobody's claiming this is the silver bullet. What we are absolutely saying is we need to demonstrate to the court that we are exploring and have explored every avenue for addressing the issue in the round. Some of that is about exercising the powers we have and exhausting all the options there. Some of that was about the council absolutely laying out in black and white what additional powers we would seek to make. Letters have been published, sent to the previous Secretary of State, and the Chief Executive and I had a specific discussion with the appropriate Minister a week or so ago about that as well. But part of that is absolutely exploring provision as well as enforcement. Now, on the transit side, the Police and Crime Commissioner has written to the leaders of every Essex Council and recommended specifically that there are 2 transit sites in Essex, one in Colchester and one in Battle. But equally, we need to explore every option. Now, I'm not saying there's going to be a transit site in Harlow, but we absolutely need to look at what the options are. Now, we have looked at a range of possible sites, but I repeat again, we have 2 sites with planning permission that are supposedly owned and managed by St County Council for the provision of travellers. Now, I will absolutely say that I don't believe that the management of this particular site by St County Council has been in any way adequate. Councillor Karen Kempner, in her county council capacity, has had a tour of the site, and if any councillor hasn't been round and thinks that this is going to be some, you know, laying a bit of concrete stuff, they really ought to go around and have a look at that site. But as raised it specifically with the cabinet member for Essex County Council, Councillor Roger Hurst, I hope to encourage Councillor Hurst to do a tour with myself and the local police inspector. So, talk about the planning, talk about the injunction. Now, in terms of the impact on local residents, absolutely, I'm acutely aware that partly because of the management by Essex County Council, or rather, lack of appropriate management, that has caused issues with local residents in and around the area. And I do see this as an opportunity to have a clean start, and then working with Essex County Council, with their statutory obligation to manage this site, and the police, and Harlow Council to address that problem. But it is addressing all the issues in the round. And if we are going to go back to the course, and it's not August, by the way, it might be September, October, if we are going to go back to the court, we have to demonstrate that in addition to the thousands of pages of evidence and thousands of photographs that were submitted before the court, that we have explored every option, both in terms of enforcement and provision. And this is one piece of that jigsaw. Not a silver bullet, no one telling it is, but it is absolutely an essential piece of that jigsaw.
So, as the Cabinet Member for Regeneration Enterprise, can I concur with most of what you've actually said, Chair? Because actually, the group have been looking for a period of time to see how we could find a suitable and sustainable site that is required by the Council to bring it to use. It is therefore quite sensible and logical that we actually looked at the pre-existing sites to see what could be done. And actually, if you go back to history, the idea is Essex County Council build that site to accommodate a further growth in that particular area. But it was Essex County Council, for whatever reason, decided that they didn't need to go down that further, so therefore they did not increase the site. As a local resident in there, in quite close to this area, I know the hostility, I know the anger, and I know the anguish that has been taking place in relation to the breakdown between the two communities that should coexist in this particular area. So actually, this is, I believe, a brave and courageous move for a fresh start. It's actually saying that we now recognise the problem and we need to address that problem. And we need to do that in a mature and effective way that includes all partners, but this has to be led and this has to be controlled, and this has to be run by Essex County Council. What we are trying to do is open the opportunity for Essex to look at this, to explore this, and to find a suitable, safe, and long-term solution that is mutually beneficial to the travelling community, but also for the wider community in that particular area. But I do agree with you, Chair, is that there does need, but it's the responsibility of Essex County Council, to open up a discussion, open up a dialogue, and actually address the real and genuine issues that local residents feel at this present time about that site and what has been happening over a period of time. But actually, Harlow Council should be proud of standing up and saying, we want to try to do something about it, rather than just trying to hide away pretend it's not going to happen, because we've got to find a solution to this, and I welcome the recommendation made by the Cabinet Member.
Are there any further contributions?
Right,
so recommendations on page 158. And also mentioned on page 2 of the agenda, in case anyone thought we were trying to hide it. Right, moving on to item 19A, the annual government's referral from Northern Science Committee, the annual government's statement, on page 162.
I've moved this, Chair.
Any I'll cut it in. Any questions, comments?
No.
No. Sorry. All agreed.
Great.
Move the council statement. Thank you very much. Next item, I propose to take these on block, which is unless anyone's got any sort of comments, which is the to note the minutes of various meetings 20A to D. Any questions? So noted. There are no items of urgent business. I conclude this meeting.